Well, good morning, Journey Church. We're so glad that you're here with us this morning. Let's get excited as we enter into a new year, just worshiping our God for who He is and everything that He's done for us. Come on, we put our hands together.
You have come and we have found life everlasting. Now alive to know your freedom, never ending. You alone have made a way for us. In your love, you are life. Believing in the light of my Savior, dancing in the arms of forever, singing like I'm walking. In your life, your light uncovered the world to see now. You alone have made a way for us. In your love, you are life. Believing in the light of my Savior, dancing in the arms of forever, singing like I'm walking on water. Your love is all I want now. You are life, oh yes. You are life, alive in me. For all the world to find your love, for all the world to see that you are God, forever be lifted high.
Everybody, welcome to church. Man, it's so good to be here with you all. Happy 2019. Happy New Year. Man, God is going to do incredible things in this place this year. We know it. We're expecting of it. Before we continue in worship, would you just take a second, find somebody you don't know, introduce yourself today.
The heavens.
voice of triumph to the glittering reign of the Lord. Come on, do you believe it? Lift it up so we will not be moved. Shall reign, he shall reign forever. Strongholds now surrender, for the Lord our God is known. Come on, lift your voice if you believe it. Who can be against us? Jesus, our defender. He's Lord. He has overcome. He shall reign forever. Strongholds now.
Overwhelming, never-ending rest.
won't climb up coming after me. Come on, this is for you. Sing it out. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
It's true.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. Today. Amen. Well, as many of you know, about 3 months ago on October 15th, I became a father for the first time. And as you can imagine, especially you parents, my world has been completely turned upside down in every possible way. And it has been one of the most glorious experiences of my life. And if you haven't met him already, I'd like to introduce to you, this is Eric Andrew McQuitty. And you know, when I look into his eyes when he came into the world, stared him in those piercing crystal blue eyes, I tried to conjure the words to express to him how I felt about him and how much I loved him. And I've probably said a lot of different things, but one thing that kind of keeps recurring is I love you more than you could possibly ever imagine, that I could ever describe in words. I don't know how I can do it, but everything that I know, I want to teach you. And everything that I have is yours. And I kind of had this moment where I remembered that scripture in 1 John that says, imagine what kind of love the Father gives, that He calls us children of God. And I had this moment where I realized that same thing that I whisper into my son's ear, God has been whispering into mine my entire life. He says, I love you more than you could possibly imagine. All that I have is yours. And he doesn't just say it. He doesn't just say that he loves me. He doesn't just say all I have is yours. He demonstrated it. He demonstrates it in the Bible, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son to come and to live in our midst, to die a criminal's death, and to resurrect the third day into the heavenlies, that we might know him, that we might know that God loves us. And this morning, I feel like that is a word from the Father to all of us today. He's saying to you, I love you more than you could possibly imagine. And all that I have is yours. Would you just close your eyes if you're comfortable? Would you hold out your hands? When we hold our hands out in worship, it's an outward expression of something that's happening internally. And there may be some of you in this place today that need to receive that love. The King of Heaven calls you a child. The King of Heaven calls you a son and a daughter. The King of Heaven says, all I have is yours. Your inheritance is the heavens. Your inheritance is eternal life, righteous standing with me. Despite your past, despite what you've done, I call you son, I call you daughter. As we sing this song, would you just let that whisper of the Father into your ear, all I have is yours, just echo in this room. Would you just reflect on it? Would you let your hearts be filled with gratitude for it? Father, we thank you for your love. We recognize that it's beyond comprehension. We can't possibly imagine the height, the depth, the width that you have for us and your love and your grace and your mercy. So we praise you. We worship you. never know how wide your love is for me. There will never be a God like you, a love so true. There has never been, this is the truth, there will never be a God like you, a love so true. There has never been, come on, there will never be a God like you, a love so true. There has never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true.
Love at a different level, and it's forever, as Jonathan shared with you guys, changed my perspective of how God feels about me. As I was leaving this morning, the two boys were in bed. They're both looking up with their heads. They were covered in the sheets and the blankets. They're just, two heads are just looking at me, you know. And I was like, oh, I don't even want to leave them this morning. That's how much I love them. And I hope you know, no matter what you walk through, that's how God feels about you. He does genuinely love you, and not just the world. He loves you. He knows the hairs on your head. He knows your name. He knows everything you've walked through in your life, and he loves you. And I hope you understand. Amen. You guys can be seated. Well, it is good to be here with you guys, and Happy New Year. I guess that I could say that for the first time with you. And if you're new to Journey, we're glad you're here. My name is Scott. I'm one of the pastors here. And we're just glad you're here to see what God's doing in this community. I truly believe that we have and are blessed with some of the most amazing people you have ever seen, and that God is doing remarkable and incredible things here. And if you want to learn more about how to get involved in our church, or just if we could pray for you and help you in any way, if you just want to fill out one of those connection cards that are in front of your seat, and you can drop that in one of the giving boxes on the way out, it's just our way to connect with you and our way to do some, you know, if there's any prayer requests, and also get up to date, because we're going to be doing so many things. Like, we once a month get together, do First Saturday Serve, and we just help and pour out in the community. There's so many small groups and opportunities to get involved, and so many things that we're involved in from here and all over the world. If you want to be a part of what God is doing here, just give us that information and drop that in a giving box, and it's a great way for us to be a part and us do that whole thing together. So I also want to say, because I was in Boynton last weekend, so I wasn't here, I want to thank all of you for all that you guys did to make Christmas happen at Journey Church from the bottom of my heart. You guys can clap, because you guys were amazing. And not just Christmas, we shared this last week, but if you missed it, like, December was one of the most epic months in the history of our church. Not only did we have the biggest service and all the, you know, lots of people and all that stuff, but what most importantly was this: we saw 380 people in 4 weeks give their lives to Jesus, right? Like, that is remarkable, and that's why we do at the movies, that's why we do these things. And I'm proud of you for going out and reaching out and inviting your friends to come in. And what was so amazing is that they got to see and experience how awesome Jesus is. And so thank you, and because of you, we're able to do all of those things. And real quick, before we get into what I really want to talk about, for those of you, we don't take an offering here at Journey, but those of you that give, we're just grateful because of you, we're able to do all the things that we get to do. And if you've been a part of recurring giving, in other words, a lot of people do that just once a month or whatever it is. They just kind of set something automatic. It's automated. We've gone to a new giving platform. It works a lot better for everything that we do and all the stuff, the way it incorporates with all the information across all the churches. And so all of you that were involved in the old stuff, if you want to continue to give, and we hope that you do, you need to go re-sign up and redo that. If you're on the app, it's really simple. You just click a button. It'll take you right there and just re-sign up and redo everything, because the new platform is just much better and smoother in the way it works for all of that going into the future. So we're just going to ask you, if you're wondering, hey, why wasn't money taken out? It's because we've gone to a whole new platform in 2019. And if you go on the website, if you don't use the app, you go to the website, you might need to refresh the page one time to get it to show up, and it'll walk you through. It takes you like 1 minute, and you can update all of that for the new year as we continue to be generous and as God continues to honor and bless those as we continue to honor and bless Him and we give towards the vision of what God is doing here at Journey Church. Well, originally, I wasn't supposed to be here today because I was with my boys in Orlando and we were on a boycation, just the three of us and my dog, so technically four boys. Then we kind of went away to Disney for a couple days and it was so just a real good time. But we're doing something so special next week that I said I want to come back and I want to make this announcement myself because I want to share with you what we're going to be doing and launching next week. How many of you have ever kind of, whether it's read the Bible or heard stories or whatever that is in your life, and you hear you're talking about God and you go, man, I wish God moved like that. I wish I could hear God's voice like that. I wish I could experience God like that. You know, and there's this other level that you're facing. Or how many of you are facing obstacles in your life and you're going, I've just tried and I prayed and it's not happening. The marriage is still in this struggle. I'm still battling with those emotions. I can't conquer some of those things. And you just really have a need for God to do something extra in your life in this year. Or you, like I said, you want to go to another level with God. You want God to overcome some obstacles. You need Him to do some great things in your life. You want to experience God like you hear so many people talk about God and you want more of God. One of the things that we don't realize in the Bible is that so many of the stories, pretty much all of the key figures in the scriptures, they all had one thing in common, that is this. They often and regularly fasted before God. And a lot of people don't realize this, but there is a fast, which is basically giving up food. All right, you give up food as this act of faith, going, I'm going to deny my flesh what I desire. And by giving up food, God says it adds power to your prayer. And we don't fully understand how it works, but there's a supernatural promise that God gives. In fact, Jesus says this, that there are some obstacles that you will face in your life that perseverance and prayer are not enough. In other words, you can work as hard as you want, you can pray all you want. They will not be enough to conquer that obstacle, to overcome that barrier, to be free of something for God to answer. That he says that only way that comes is about prayer and fasting. And so one of the things that we're going to invite you to do, we've never done this before in our church, and I really feel like this is where God is leading us to do, is I'm going to invite us as a church to go on a 21-day fast together. And we're going to be easy. Like, it's not like fasting all of food, right? So here's what we're going to do. In the Bible, there's a guy named Daniel. Daniel went on this 21-day this fast, and God did miracles and these incredible things in his life. We're going to talk a little about all that stuff, right? And did just amazing things through fasting. I've seen God do so many things through fasting. And so we're going to do kind of a Daniel fast primarily as a church, and we're going to ask everyone to be a part of this. And what that's going to mean basically is you're just going to basically give up sugar, meat, alcohol, those types, you know, and fried foods, those sort of things. You're going to eat vegetables and water. It's actually healthy. It's not about a diet, although some of us probably could use a diet. This is not about a diet, by the way. This is about inviting the incredible power of God into your lives that will help you both spiritually and physically. And we believe God's going to do miracles through this fast. We're going to hear stories. I've been doing this many, many years. And I can't tell you, and I'll share some more in these messages coming up these next 4 weeks. God has just done incredible things through fasting. I can't wait to share some of the stories, things that just blow your mind. And it wasn't through prayers. When I decided to fast, God moved in supernatural ways. And here's the thing, I want this for you guys. And I want this for your kids. I want your kids to grow up understanding, right? Because mom and dad set the example of the power, because you know what? You never know when you're gonna need that power. And you never know when you're going to need to, and you're going to walk through an obstacle, and you're going to need that extra strength from God. And so our hope is not just our church, but our families are going to participate in this. And we're going to see God. We're going to pray for miracles. We're going to pray for God to do things in your marriages, in your families, in your business, in your finances. We've got a magnet for you to kind of all things pray for. And here's what else we've done for you. We have this book that we want to give out or get to you. And it's a 21-day kind of a reading plan. And you have a little bookmark every day, kind of gives you what we're all going to read, which is imagine thousands of us reading through the same plan, the same devotions every day. Because if you just give up food and you don't spend time, if you don't spend time seeking God, you're going to miss out on so much what God has for you. And we wanted the staff to do this. I wanted the staff to do this first before I went to you. So months ago, we did this. And I know some of you right now, you're like, that's just ridiculous. It's too much. There's no way you can do it. It's so hard. Listen, when I told the staff we were doing this, you should have seen their faces, right? They were not happy. But can I tell you something? At the end of the 21 days, every single one of them was like, this is life-changing. This is powerful. And you're going to hear some of their stories as well. It was incredible. So not only are we going to get this book, and by the way, we're selling the book for $5. It cost us $9.50 a book, which means we're eating like $4.50 for every single person that gets this book. But this is how much we want and believe in you. We're going to invest in you. We're going to eat money just so that you can be a part of this with your family. It is one of my favorite parts of the fast with my wife and I. Was when we did this and read this book together. It was just such a great and incredible and amazing. Here's what else we're doing. One of the things that we did that was so powerful is we all the staff and all their husbands and wives came over to our house, and we did this amazing worship night with our incredible worship leaders, real acoustic thing. We prayed over each other, laid hands on her, and you can't put in words what we saw God do that night. And so I said, I want to give everyone in our church the opportunity to do that. But how do we do that with all of our campuses? So we're going to have 6 separate nights where we're going to limit the attendance to like 150 people. You have to get a ticket. You don't have to buy it, just to sign up. And then we're going to kind of get in the round, and we're going to have these intimate living room worship experiences if you sign up for the fast, by the way. So if you sign up for the fast, when you sign up for the fast, at the end of the service, you just walk out in the lobby, you sign up, there'll be all kinds of iPads there. You got some of this instructions last week, right? And you just sign up. I'm going to commit to this 21-day fast. We've even got 3 other fasts. If you can't do the Daniel fast, just fast sugar. We've got something called Freedom Fast, which means maybe there's an addiction in your life you need to release and let go of, and you're going to commit for 21 days to surrender to God. Or maybe, you're younger, social media. And you could just, take some time. We got opportunities. So you're going to go up and sign up. And when you can, that means you get to sign up for this living room experience where you're going to be surrounded by our worship team, and we're going to be in these circles, and people are going to pray for you if you want prayer. And you're going to encounter God, I believe, in new and amazing ways. Now, here's why I came back and drove home at 5 in the morning so I could be here for you guys. As your pastor, here's what I'm asking you. I'm asking you to do this. I know you don't want to. I know you think it's ridiculous. I know for some of you, you just don't want to do it. But can I tell you something? You need this. There is a level that God wants to take you that he can't take you there until you do this. There are things God wants to do in your life that he will not do in your life until you do this. And this is going to be a discipline that I hope is not just 21 days, that goes through the rest of your life, that you learn to tap into a power that God wants to do miraculous things. And as your pastor, I'm asking you as a favor to me, I want you to do it. Men, I want you to step up and lead your household on how to seek God and want more of God. This is that opportunity for you guys to come together to do this. And I truly believe that when you get thousands of people praying and fasting for each other, we are going to look back in these 21 days and we are going to see God do some amazing things. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the power of fasting and praying. And God, I just cannot wait. I cannot wait to see what you're going to do in my life and in our church's lives and our families and our marriages and the next generation as our students walk through this. God, I am so excited to just experience your presence in a tangible, touchable way. God, I just pray you give people the strength, the boldness to step up and seek more of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Journey Church. Oh,
Well, to all of you and the Boynton campus, everybody online, Happy New Year. May this year treat you well. You know, there's nothing magical about a new year, but we can posture ourselves to be in such a position where we can engage a new year in a just more anticipated way. I am so excited about this 21-day fast. For some of us, it's come just in time. But you know, as we position ourselves for this fast, it's going to have a wonderful effect on our bodies. But I want to talk to you about how to position your soul within this season where you will be allowing your body to experience something of a rejuvenation. There's something about the rejuvenation and the purifying of your soul that is crucial to truly live this abundant life that Jesus Christ came to bring for us. And therefore, I want to share with you under the title of this message, Free. What would it look like to enter this year knowing that you're not bringing all the anxieties, the confusion, and even the relational tension into the new season? I want to start by reading a portion of Scripture in Romans chapter 12, verse 17 to 21. And we read together where Paul is writing and giving a reference to the church in Rome and helping them to understand how to live a life that is free. He says, "Repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men." It's interesting that Paul says, if it is possible, because he knew that it wouldn't always be possible. But he says, as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord." Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in doing so, you will heap coals of fire on his head. And here's the principle: do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is one of those portions of Scripture that really challenges us in terms of how we approach life. Paul says here, don't try and avenge. If anything negative happens, if people do things against you, give it to God and you bless them. Now, of course, we know this is a very challenging engagement. And Paul says, bless those who are your enemies, because by doing that, you will heap coals of fire onto their heads. Now, when I first read that, I thought Paul said, be nice to people who are not nice to you. In that way, you will really spite them. But that's not what Paul is saying here. And I had to go and read up, what does this heaping coals of fire onto somebody's head mean? And it's interesting. Bowen, in his book, Strange Scriptures That Perplex the Western Mind, explains this particular reference. And he says, you know, in biblical times, the fire in the house was very, very important because that brought heat to the house, but it also was used for cooking and for various other things. And so they had to protect that fire and make sure that it never goes out. But if it did go out, it was a challenge for them to start a fire. It's not like today where we have all the things that we can use to start a fire. For them, it was, you know, it was kind of ancient in their engagement. So the easiest way to start a fire, and the custom at that stage was, you will go to your neighbors and ask them for a few hot coals. And then, of course, you couldn't carry those coals. You had to put it into a container. And the custom was that they would put insulation on their heads and put that bowl on top of their head as they walked back to their house. Now, he goes on to say, he said, for this reason, people carry them safely on their head in a pottery urn. If the neighbor is a generous person, he or she would heap the urn full of coals. To feed an enemy and give drink was like heaping an empty urn with live coals, which meant food, warmth, almost life itself to the person in the home needing it, and it was a symbol of the finest honor. What he was saying is, if the neighbor wanted to bless you and recognize that they really love and appreciate you, they would heap more coals into that urn so that when you walk down the street, everybody would see that you are an honored and appreciated person. Whereas if they didn't really like you, they'd just give you a few and you'd sneak home. But here's the principle. This is what Paul is using when he says, bless those who curse you. Don't avenge yourselves. Bless your enemies. He says, because it's like heaping coals, giving honor to them. Well, that's the power of the opposite spirit. We have to recognize that as children of God, as kingdom people, we live a different life. We engage life in a different way. We do not live in the same cultural reference that we came from before we met Christ. In Christ, things change in our lives. You see, it's this power of kingdom life, this power of the opposite spirit. Where there's hatred, we come with love. Where there's bitterness, we come with forgiveness. Where there's greed, we come with generosity. Where there's self-centeredness, we come and lay our lives down. The kingdom calls for a total different way of living. And it's within this context that Paul writes. Now, the reality is that many people have experienced offense in relationships, been hurt, and many times that reference becomes the dominating influence that determines how you live life. And for us as Christ followers, we have made a discovery that in Christ, we do not have to be subject to that reference, but we can live truly free. We've all been offended. But really, offense is taken. It's not really given. It's when you take offense that it affects your life, that it has an influence on how you navigate every day of your life. Because as you grew up, it could have been your parents, a colleague at work, maybe your spouse, maybe just a traumatic experience that where you feel that you were abused. Those things want to have an effect on your life. And we see how the Bible teaches us that we could actually address this because of the power of Christ within us. If you do not address it, offense has opportunity to bring bitterness into your life. And I want to share a few things with you about the effect of bitterness in our lives. Listen to this scripture when Paul writes in, or the Hebrew writer writes in Hebrews 12 verse 15. He says, "Look carefully lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many people become defiled." I don't know if you've sensed that, but where people carry offense, where people have bitterness in their hearts, it affects many people. If you've been around a bitter person, it kind of sits on you. It gets to you. You feel it because this is what dominates their life. Now, bitterness leads to the following four things. The first thing is psychosomatic illnesses. Now, this is a big word, but really psychosomatic is two Greek words, psycho, which means the mind and the emotions, and soma, which means the body. And really what it means is it has its origin in the mind, in the emotions, but it reflects in the body. Many illnesses have their root in terms of the emotion and the thought life of people. It's amazing how your mind affects your body. Let me give you a few examples. If you had to go for an interview and you were a little nervous and you're sitting there in the waiting room, what happens to the palms of your hands? Suddenly they get sweaty. Why? Because your mind is telling you you're anxious. And now the body is responding in a particular way. You feel that in your hands. You don't have a sweaty switch that you put on. You just have to think. And your mind now affects the way you feel. If you are embarrassed, what happens? You blush. If you feel you walk into a room and it's kind of eerie, what do you people say? The hair in the back of your neck stands up. How does that hair know? Now you see, you're thinking stuff, listen to this, you're thinking stuff and it's affecting your body. If there's an excitement, your heart starts racing, your heart starts beating. Listen to this, there are so many instances that prove that the mind and the body are interconnected. And so if you carry the wrong things in your mind, if you harbor these things in your emotions, they will have an effect on your body. The
Mayo Foundation for Medical Education and Research says the following, and I quote, "Letting go of grudges and bitterness can make way for improved health and peace of mind. Forgiveness, they say, can lead to healthier relationships, improved mental health, less anxiety, stress and hostility, lower blood pressure, fewer symptoms of depression, stronger immune system, improved heart health, and improved self-esteem." How many of you would like to have this year free of all of those things? Well, they say, forgive. The implication is if you do not forgive and bitterness gets hold of your life, it'll affect your relationships, it'll affect your mental health, it'll affect anxiety, stress, and hostility in your life, blood pressure, depression, immune system, heart health, and self-esteem will be affected. Can you see how important it is to understand that we should not be keeping things against others? Not only does it lead to psychosomatic illnesses, but it feeds the self-life and empowers the negative past. It feeds the self. You see, part of our problem is we many times struggle still with self. You might be sitting here and saying, well, at least that's not me. That one's not me. Not self. Really? Let me give you a quick little exercise. If we had to take a nice photograph of this audience and flip it around, put it on the screen, guess who's the first person you're going to look for? And then you're concerned, oh, that's not a nice photo. They didn't get me the right angle. So, you see, we all have to deal with self. You can discern when a person is trapped when their first response is, you don't understand what they did to me. You see, it's that reference of myself. And this is where the kingdom life wants to come in. God wants us to lay down our self so that His life can become evident in our lives. He wants you to move from your own personal ego to the kingdom ecosystem. Self. We are first set free from sin in our journey with Christ, and then we are set free from self. Bitterness helps to engender the sense of self. But it doesn't just do that, it darkens your mind. It clouds your thinking. Listen to 1 John chapter 2, verse 11, where John is speaking. He says, "He who hates his brother or keeps something against his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes." He lives in darkness. In other words, you can't really live a free life. It's as if you're in the dark. It's as if this thing is clouding your vision and you can't see with clarity. You see, the problem with offense is it so affects your life that you start to harbor that experience in a way where you kind of make your own movie, and consistently you're playing this movie in your mind. In the morning when you get up, at night when you go to bed, you're playing this movie in your mind, and it starts to dominate and control your life. Consumes your thinking. And that, of course, leads to the next thing. It leads to thoughts of revenge. It's when you create another movie, the new movie. How am I going to make sure that they pay for it? How do I get revenge? How do I, back home we would say quits. Here you would say get even. How do I get even? You know, it's like the elderly lady that was going shopping went to one of the malls and she was looking for parking, it was full. And so she drives into one of those lanes and kind of waits there. And you know what it's like? Once you wait there, you kind of emotionally reserve that area. It's now your area, right? And so she's waiting for a parking spot to go open. And sure enough, people come and put their little packages in the car and close the trunk, get in the car. And she gets ready to move in. And as that car moves out, there are a few students that come in with this rickety little car and they see this opportunity and see the ladies taking too long and they shoot in and they take the parking spot. And oh my goodness, heartburn. She can't believe what has just happened. And so the kids get out of the car and they're on the way to the mall and she drops her window and she calls them and she says, "Why did you do that?" And kind of with a great attitude, one of the students says, "Because we're young and we're fast." She decides somebody's got to teach them a lesson. She's got this beautiful big German car, but she puts that into drive and she slams the accelerator and she rams into that car. You just see her glass. And she puts it back into reverse. She's got this grin on her face. And she's back and she's ready again and she rams into it again. By that time, the students are there and she drops the window and the students say, "Why did you do that?" She says, "Because I'm old and I'm rich." Oh, that feeling of revenge. You know, here's the bad part of it. It's when you know that you're able to have them pay back that it's the biggest challenge. Because bitterness leads you to engage in this way. That's why Paul writes, he says, "Beloved, don't avenge yourselves, but give place for the wrath. Because it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord." It's as if Paul is saying, God knows all about this. You don't have to make them pay. I heard somebody share once, he said, "I had been hurt and I told God, somebody should pay for this. And in his kind, loving, tender way, he said to me, 'I paid.'" So how do we release ourselves from these things that have come with us? And how do we posture ourselves for the new year so that we can release ourselves and be free from these things that want to keep us in bondage? The Bible says we should forgive. And there's power in forgiveness. And so I want to share with you four things that forgiveness will bring into your life, or four principles about forgiveness. Because you see, bitterness empowers the negative past, but forgiveness empowers your future. And the first principle of forgiveness is forgive because you are forgiven. You see, that's the reason why we can forgive, because we have stood at the receiving end of forgiveness. We know what it is to be forgiven. Peter, one of the disciples, probably having a bit of a rough day. And he had a bit of bother, it seems, with some people. And so he's listening to Jesus, and Jesus is talking about living this life of forgiveness and being free. And so Paul decides he's going to come to Jesus and ask him, Lord, how many times on one day do I need to forgive? And he thought he'd set the bar pretty high. So he said, 7 times? In other words, what Peter was saying, Lord, if people offend me consistently and I've forgiven them 7 times in one day, does that mean I can draw the line and no longer release them? And then Jesus makes this statement and says, Peter, how about 70 times 7? What Jesus was saying to him, Peter, what I'm introducing to you is not, you know, you counting how many times you release these people. I'm talking about bringing you into a lifestyle where you will be consistently free. It's Paul that writes in Colossians 3, verse 13, he says, bear with each other. Forgive one another if any of you has any grievance against someone. Because, listen to this, forgive as the Lord forgave you. As. Forgive as the Lord has forgiven you, because you have been at the receiving end of God's forgiveness. You are now empowered to be able to forgive. But you know, many people would say, I desperately want to forgive, but I can't seem to forget. And because I can't forget, it doesn't feel to me as if I can forgive. Well, that's the second important thing that you need to understand. Forgiveness is not about forgetting. Forgiveness means to refocus. You see, if you want to forget about something, well, for that, you either need a brain operation or somebody to give you a shot against the head. You're not going to forget about it. You see, it's interesting that even when God forgives us, nowhere in the Bible does it say God forgets about our sins. The Bible's very clear. It says, God says, I will not think about your sins. I will not call your sins into remembrance. I will not be reminding myself about your sins. You see, God is the all-knowing God. God can never not know anything. And some of the great people of Scripture, well, their lives are documented in the Bible. And every once in a while, we remind God about the sins of David and Moses and all the people of the Bible. It's not as if God forgets about that. God chooses not to think about that. Let me explain it this way. I have this little iPad. If I want to keep this iPad against this table, I have to put in energy to keep it against, right? It's not going to be there unless I put in energy. And so for me to keep it against, I have to actively make sure that I keep it there. But the moment I no longer put in energy, what's going to happen? It's going to fall away. That's exactly the same with forgiveness. Forgiveness does not mean that you forget about it. It means you choose not to make that your focus. It means you choose not to put energy into keeping it against those people. It's a choice. Forgiveness is that you choose. And if you're reminded of that, if you are in a situation where you're confronted with that on a daily basis, you choose not to put energy into that. See, if you truly want to live free, this is one of the biggest choices you can ever make. Not only that, but many people would say, I can't forgive because I don't feel I want to forgive. And I want to be true to myself. I want to live with integrity. I can't say that I'm forgiving, but I don't feel that I want to forgive you. I don't feel like I want to release. Well, the principle here is that it has nothing to do with your emotions. Forgiveness is a decision regardless of your emotions. There are certain things you do because you know it's right. You might say, but you know, I want to live in touch with myself. Well, you know, it's like tomorrow morning, some of you are going to wake up and you need to go to work. But you might be in bed and you don't feel that you want to get up. And you want to live with integrity. And so, you know, you want to be in touch with yourself. And so you decide that you're going to stay in bed until you feel that you're going to go to work. Now, if you get up there, we don't say that you're not in living with integrity and you're not in touch with yourself. We're just saying you're being responsible. You're doing what is right. You know it's the right thing to do. Listen to me. You don't forgive because you feel you want to forgive. You forgive because you know it's the right thing to do. Here's what it's really all about. When you forgive, the fourth principle, by forgiving, you set yourself free. You see, many people say, but I don't want to forgive them because it feels like they're getting away with it. It's like they have to pay. I can't just release them. You know, many times they're carrying on with their lives. They're unaware of you feeling all these feelings, but you're still harboring these feelings. You know, it's like somebody once said, it's like drinking rat poison and expecting the rat to die. When you forgive, it actually has to do with you more than it has to do with them. And if you truly want to engage this year in a sense that you sense that you are living free, this is one of the most important keys to experiencing release in your own life. Here in Matthew chapter 6, we see how Jesus says, "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." It's a difficult scripture, but it doesn't mean that God has not forgiven us. But here's what I believe the scripture says. It says that if you do not release others, the release that God has for your life cannot find opportunity in your life. It's as if you stop the processes of God in your life because you choose not to forgive. Because God wants to forgive you. Listen to the Jubilee translation of verse 14. He says, "If you set men free from their trespasses, your heavenly Father will set you free." You see, forgiveness is actually a gift that God has given to you to set yourself free. Horace Bushnell made this statement. He says, to forgive is man's highest achievement and his deepest need. Forgiveness is man's highest achievement, but his deepest need. There's something that Jesus came to teach us about giving, being able to give. The highest form of giving is to forgive. As you enter this year, as you enter this season, as you posture yourself and your soul for the season that lies ahead, I invite you to engage in this moment, asking yourself, what do I need to release? Who do I need to forgive? So if I can ask you for a moment, would you, wherever you are, just close your eyes. And right now, as we prepare our hearts to come before God in prayer, you might just want to use this moment to make a choice, to release, to forgive, to even bless, so that your soul can prosper. So that you can engage as a free person. Father, we thank you that you chose to forgive us even when we were enemies, when we were far from you, when we postured our lives against you. You forgave us. And Lord, we now, as the people that have received forgiveness and know what it is to be released, we come to release. I pray for every individual that has heard this word and recognizes, Lord, that you are speaking to them right now, and that they sense the challenge to release, to forgive, to bless. I thank you that through the Holy Spirit they sense the empowerment to be able to do that. We thank you, Lord, that we can engage this new season with anticipation in the knowledge that we can live totally free. We thank you. We honor you for your goodness in our lives, and we pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless.
Amen. Come on, Journey. How many of you just want to walk into 2019 in freedom? Anybody in this place? Come on. Can you get a little bit louder? How many of you want to walk in freedom? Come on. Yes. Walk in freedom. Let's continue to just celebrate. Pastor, how many of you just love when Pastor Allen's here? Just appreciate and value to the depth of his teaching. So good. Well, listen, if you're in here and you're saying, man, I want freedom, but I'm just not sure how to get it. I know this. Any time that you come to Jesus in prayer, he's going to answer that thing. And so our prayer team will be down front. They want to partner with you. They want to stand in the gap with you. And they want to believe alongside of you. So make sure to see them before you take off. And earlier, Pastor Scott was talking about our fast coming up in the More of God series. I want to encourage you to go out in the lobby. You're going to find some people with white shirts on just like this. I want to encourage you, sign up for the fast. When you sign up for the fast, grab that book. It's only $5. Just
be a part of all that God is going to do through this season, and make sure when you sign up, you're going to get an email that you're going to have the chance to register for those worship nights. You're going to want to be at those nights, but it is limited space. You're going to want to make sure you sign up early. Make sure to do that. Guys, listen, Journey Church, we're going to walk in freedom in this year. I believe that, and I want other people to walk in that freedom as well. On your seats, you have some invites. Invite some people to come back with you next week, because we know that we will not conform, but we will live transformed. Have a great week.